Om Namah Shivaya students, we were continuing with the literature chapter My Childhood, which is an extract taken from the autobiographical novel of APJ Abdul Kalam, Wings of Fire. And until now, we have read that APJ Abdul Kalam was born in a middle-class Muslim family in 1931 in the island town of Rameshwaram, Tamil Nadu. In his childhood days, he was greatly influenced by his parents, his teachers and his friends. His father, Jainulabdin, was not highly educated, but he was a generous and kind person. He was not rich, but provided a secure childhood to Abdul and his siblings. And Abdul had inherited honesty and self-discipline from his father and faith in goodness and deep kindness from his mother. And we have also learned that Abdul had earned his first wages by working as a helping hand to his cousin Samsuddin, who distributed newspapers in Rameshwaram. We have also get to know that in his childhood days, he had three close friends, Ramananda Shastri, Aravindam and Shiva Prakasham. Now students, we will continue with the next part. And I would tell all to have your insert book open at page 70 with a pencil in your hand so that you may jot down all the important points as I go through the same. Today we will start from point number 6. One day when I was in the 5th standard at the Rameshwaram Elementary School, a new teacher came to our class. I used to wear a cap which marked me as a Muslim, and I always sat in the front row to Ramananda Shastri, who wore the sacred thread. So it happened so that Abdul Kalam recalled one instant when he was in 5th standard that a new teacher came to their class, and he immediately identified him as a Muslim boy as he was wearing a cap on his head, and Ramananda Shastri, who was sitting just next to him, as a Hindu Brahmin as he was wearing the sacred thread. Okay, the new teacher could not stomach is a phrasal verb, a Hindu priest's son sitting with a Muslim boy. In accordance with a social ranking, as the new teacher saw it. So according to him, social ranking should be something different. Abdul Kalam was asked to go and sit on the back bench. I felt very bad, and so did Ramananda Shastri. Why they felt very bad? Because they have never come across such ambience of situation. They have been always brought up in the same ambience, mingling up with each other. So they have never seen the difference of religious barrier which the new teacher wanted to make them understand. So that's why when Abdul Kalam was shifting his seat to the last bench, Ramananda Shastri was crying bitterly, was weeping, and that moment of crying left an indelible impression on Abdul Kalam's mind for the lifetime, which he recalled even after 50 years when he was actually writing his autobiography. Okay. So after school, we went home and told our respective parents about the incident. Lakshmana Shastri summoned the teacher and in our presence told the teacher that he should not spread the poison of social inequality and communal intolerance in the minds of innocent children. He bluntly asked the teacher to either apologize or quit the school and the island. Not only did the teacher regret his behavior, but the strong sense of conviction Lakshmana Shastri conveyed ultimately reformed this young teacher. So students, what happened over here, you know? After that day's school, both the children went home and told their respective parents about that incident. And Ramananda Shastri's father, Lakshmana Shastri, then called the new teacher and scolded him. He told him that he should not have spreaded the poison of discrimination of caste and religion into the minds of the innocent minds, because they have never seen such situation. They have never faced such situation in their life. And Lakshmana Shastri was very much clear in himself. He was very much clear about his thoughts. He told the teacher that either he should ask sorry for the behavior that he had done, or else he should leave the school and Rameshwaram's town as well. The teacher then apologized for the mistake that he had done, and due to Lakshmana Shastri's determination, that is the way that he delivered, that the way that he made him understood, his thoughts about religion and caste also changed. He was then a reformed person. Then let's move to point number 8. On the whole, the small city of Rameshwaram was very rigid in terms of the segregation of different social groups. However, my science teacher Sivra Subramania Iyer, though an Orthodox Brahmin with a very conservative wife, was something of a rebel. He did his best to break social barriers so that people from varying backgrounds could mingle easily. He used to spend hours with me and would say, "Kalam, I want you to develop so that you are on par with the highly educated people of the big cities." Underline the line. So, this city, the division of society of the Rameshwaram city was very much rigid. Okay, but Abdul Kalam, science teacher about whom we are talking here, he was a very rebellious person, though he was a religious person. Though he was very much religious one, but he was very much rebellious about these divisions of the society. He did not believe in distinction on the basis of the caste system, and he had worked very hard to break these social barriers. What he wanted people of different castes should come forward and they should mix up, they should interact with each other. That's why he encouraged APJ Abdul Kalam also to work hard so that he could be at the same level as the highly educated people who lived in big cities. So this was the belief, you know, the people who live in big cities, they are highly educated, whereas people living in small towns, they are not that much eligible. So Kalam's teacher, the science teacher, wanted to break this particular mindset of the people. He believed that all these things can be from anywhere. Anyone great can be from any place. That's why he always encouraged APJ Abdul Kalam to become one of the greatest men of the country. Okay, so then what happened? One day he invited me to his home for a meal. His wife was horrified at the idea of a Muslim boy being invited to dine in her ritually pure kitchen. Very important, ritually pure kitchen. That means kept protected from all outside influences for the observance of religion. She was a very much true believer of religion according to her belief. Okay. And one day, his science teacher invited Abdul Kalam to their house to have dinner with them. She refused to serve me in her kitchen because she did not feel like that a Muslim boy should be allowed in her kitchen to have food. But Shiva Subramania was not perturbed. He was not disturbed by this because he did not want to disrespect his wife's belief about religion. Nor did he get angry with his wife because the society was like that. That's why he did not want to hurt, or he did not want to feel bad his wife. That's why he did not take Kalam into the kitchen. Rather, he had food with him. And that's why what he did, but instead served me his own hands and sat down beside me to eat his meal. So Shiva Subramania Iyer and Kalam had their food together. His wife watched us from behind the kitchen door. I wondered whether she had observed any difference in the way I ate rice, drank water, or cleaned the floor after the meal. So, while they were having food, they were being watched by his science teacher's wife. Now, that time, APJ Abdul Kalam is saying that he wonders whether she had found out any difference in the way he and his teacher were having food or drinking water or cleaning the floor after having meal. Got it? So when I was leaving his house, Shiva Subramania Iyer invited me to join him for dinner again the next weekend. Observing my hesitation, he told me not to get upset, saying, "Once you decide to change the system, such problems have to be confronted." Underline the line. So again, he was invited for dinner the next weekend. And that's why definitely Kalam was feeling very much hesitated to visit their house once more. Now that time, understanding or feeling his hesitation, the science teacher told that if he had made up his mind to change the society, he has to confront such opposite situations. So that's why he should come to their house to have dinner again. But a change came over there. What change? That when he visited their house next time, his wife, that means his science teacher's wife, herself served the food to Kalam, even inside her kitchen, inside her ritually pure kitchen. So When I visited the house the next week, Shiva Subramania's Iyer's wife took me inside the kitchen and served me food with her own hands. So this was the change that came immediately with the strong conviction that Shiva Subramania Iyer had in his mind. Clear? Next, point number 10. Then the Second World War was over and India's freedom was imminent. This Second World War over in the year of 1945 and India got its freedom in the year of 1947. So Indians would build their own India, declared Gandhiji. Gandhiji means father of the nation, we all know. The whole country was filled with an unprecedented optimism of hope. Whole country was filled with hope that something good is going to happen with all the Indians. I asked my father for permission to leave Rameshwaram and study at the district headquarters in Ramanathapuram. Now, APJ Abdul Kalam also wanted to pursue his higher studies, and that's why he wanted to leave Rameshwaram and go to Ramanathapuram, which is the district headquarters, so that he can pursue his higher studies. Clear? So now what happened? Point number 11, he told me as if thinking aloud, Abul, I know you have to go away to grow. Does the seagull not fly across the sun alone and without a nest? Even he quoted Khalil Gibran to my hesitant mother, your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. Underline the line, very important. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts, for they have their own thoughts. Very important to note, students. I will explain it very slowly and you should pay your utmost attention also. So, when he wanted to pursue his higher education, he asked his father's permission to go to Ramanathapuram, which was the district headquarters for higher studies. Now, in that situation, APJ Abdul Kalam's father gave the example of the bird seagull. Now, you know, seagull is a bird and it flies away in the sky all alone and does not have a nest also. That means it does not have a home of its own as it keeps on flying from one place to another. So that's why he could see the aspiring Abdul Kalam who was going to achieve the highest height of life. That's why he quoted the example of seagull to him. He wanted to inspire him so much that he should achieve the highest height of life, the pinnacle of glory of height. At that moment, definitely being a mother, that means Abdul Kalam's father is talking about his mother Ashima, who was not happy with the decision of her son going away from their home to pursue his higher studies. That time, APJ Abdul Kalam's father quoted from Khalil Gibran. Now, Khalil Gibran is a famous American poet and visual artist also. He had quoted the lines from the poem Your Children. These are the lines quoted from the poem Your Children, and it is written by Khalil Gibran. He said that your children are not your children. They are the children of life who are supposed to great achievements, who are supposed to achieve something in life. And you should not think that you can rule your children. They are a result of life's desire for itself. They have their own thoughts. He asked her to give them freedom to fulfill their thoughts. Over here, there is a line, you may give them your love, but not your thoughts. That means you should not overburden your children with your own thoughts. They should have their own thoughts. One more point he has mentioned, that they come through you but not from you. Through you means you are the medium through which the creator or the God has sent them to this material world or this earth, so that they can do something for the nation, so that they can do something for the life of others. You are a medium, but they have not come only for you. They have come for all the nation, because Abdul Kalam's father could also imagine how aspiring, or not only imagine, could understand and sense how aspiring APJ Abdul Kalam was. And he was very sure that this little boy was going to achieve the heights of life and was going to become one of the greatest men of India. Clear, students? So with this, we completed the chapter, My Childhood. I would tell all of you to read the chapter thoroughly. We are ending our class over here. In the next class, we will discuss the question answer of the chapter. Till then, thank you. Om Namah Shivaya.